Thanks very much for staying with us, viewers, throughout this day as we've been, of course, covering live the 12th Iranian presidential elections, which are taking place throughout the Islamic Republic as well as, in fact, throughout the world. It's just past 10:03 p.m. here in the Iranian capital, Tehran, and the polling stations are just as full, seemingly, and voting time has been, I think, extended till around midnight tonight by the Interior Ministry, which is one of the latest times it's ever been extended in past elections as well. This, of course, showing the fervor and enthusiasm of the Iranian people to vote, to exercise their democratic right to choose their next president, the 12th president of the Islamic Republic of Iran. Well, we have a number of experts joining us now to discuss these elections a bit further. We're joined by Professor Alexander Azadgan, who is a professor of strategic global management and international political economy. And he's joining us live now from Laguna Beach. We're also joined by Mr. Sayed Mustafa Khoshchesh, who is a political analyst, and he is joining us live from Doha. And we're also joined by Mr. Muhammad Ali Carter, who is a journalist and political commentator, and he is joining us live from London. Gentlemen, thank you all for joining us here on Press TV. Professor Azadgan, I'll start with you. I wanted to get your thoughts, Professor, of course, as, of course, voting time has been extended. We've seen the fervor and enthusiasm throughout this country and even beyond for Iranians to vote.
Well, you know, it's an interesting testament as I'm watching the views, as I'm watching the my TV, not just Press TV, but other international media. What an interesting testament that a country decides to extend its voting hours by 2 hours or 3 hours sometimes. Which other country do you have? Which other countries who claim to be part of the so-called international community actually extend their voting hours? Here in the United States, where I live, we vote on Tuesdays. This, of course, was designed by the founding, so-called founding fathers, to make sure, and they were elitists, we have to say that, to make sure as few people vote as possible. Whereas in Iran, voting is done on a Friday, a day that's off, everybody's resting. In this case, everybody's standing in lines to vote. What does that tell you about the theocratic democracy system that Iran has? So I think by people appearing, by people voting, by the interest that they're showing is a testament that they're behind the system that has been implemented in the country for the past 40 years. And also the fact that there's such a large percentage of people in Iran who vote compared to, I would say, 30 to 40% max in the United States. And in this past election, we saw in France around 35%. What does that tell you? France always talks about being the most liberal democracy in the world. Of course, we in the United States think that we are the only functioning democracy. And yet when you have such a low voter turnout, what exactly does that tell you about citizen activism and citizen participation? Whereas in Iran, we see the exact opposite. And regardless of the outcomes, this is a wonderful testament as far as Iranians' political literacy and involvement and enthusiasm.
Indeed. Mr. Khoshchesh, I wanted to get your opinion on that as well, because certainly, the Iranian participation has been something which even the Interior Ministry, its spokesperson said this time around, it seems that it may even beat previous times percentages as far as how many people are taking part in these elections.
Bismillah ar-Rahman ar-Rahim. Hello, and thanks for having me. Well, that's true. Of course, this is nothing strange. As a matter of fact, Iranians have always, showed a high turnout in elections. You know, the average for presidential elections stands at around 70 to 72%. And for parliamentary elections, it stands at around 62 to 64%. So that shows that people are fond of democracy that they have in Iran. You know, Ali was right. As he was explaining, whenever we are talking about democracy, that's the rule of the people. People in the West, especially the media outlets in the United States, try to inspire their readers that Iran is not ruled by democracy. But people throughout the world, even through CNN and others, can see now for themselves that people are so interested in taking part in the election because they believe in the system. Otherwise, they would have not turned out and they would have not gone to the polls today. So many people are taking part in the election in order to contribute their role to their sovereignty and to the decision making of their country and the future of their country. And this is very important, because whenever you have public support, no matter where you are, which country we're talking about, whenever you have a large turnout in the elections, that means public support. And why public support is needed if you are ruling a country? Because it deters enemy plots against your countries, your country, and it would discourage foreign enemies from taking hostile actions. I'm not talking about military action, but I'm talking about other enmity and hostile actions like sanctions, because little by little they will come to realize that they cannot divide this nation. As a major objective of sanctions and foreign hostile plots is to divide the people of Iran into pros and cons. But when they turn out in the election, they show that they believe in the establishment no matter who they vote for. And this is a very important point. And the other point, as Alexander explained, is that even in those countries that claim to be ruled by democracy, the average stands at around 40%. And if the candidates come up with each 20%, like Al Gore and Bush, then a country is ruled by a president who has garnered only 20% of the votes. But in Iran, you see that presidents are elected to office with over 50 to 60% of the votes, while there are many people coming to the polls. I've heard from here, even here at the embassy, it was really crowded today, and there were so many people. I never guessed that there are so many Iranians in Doha living and coming to the polls. And everybody was surprised, even people in here, the Qataris and other people living here, they were surprised to see such election and such democracy in Iran. And they were taken by surprise because, you know, this is something strange to them, especially in this part of the world where countries are stranger to elections and the kind of system that we have in Iran, that's democracy.
Mr. Carter, I wanted to get your opinion on this too, because, you know, we have obviously elections coming up in the UK pretty quickly now, in fact. And I wonder, you know, I don't want to make it just about the numbers and just the percentages, but certainly they are quite an important signal, aren't they, of how confident people are really in their respective systems of governance, that they would participate or not in elections.
Well, yes, absolutely. I mean, as far as back as I can remember, the turnout in the 2013 elections in Iran were actually around about 73%, as the last gentleman accurately pointed out. So this sits a lot higher than you find here in the UK, where, you know, typically the average turnout tends to be around 50 to 60%, depending on which election you look at. And a lot of people have been speculating that there's going to be quite a low turnout to this election, actually, that we've been having too many elections in the West and actually people are getting sick and tired of it. It's been very difficult to keep up with everything. Obviously, the French presidential elections recently ended. You had the Turkish referendum this year. And as you rightly say, we've got the UK election now and the Iranian one going on at the same time. But truly, the major difference between the UK and the Iranian election is that it seems as if a lot more people in Iran are very confident behind their system. But in fact, over here, you get kind of an opposite trend, especially around the younger generation, that tend to prefer boycotting, in many cases, the actual election process going on here and refusing to vote outright. But when you look at Iran, it seems as if a very close to almost the entire population is very, very eager to participate. You just see, I mean, the Iranian, I think it was the Iranian embassy here in London, I've seen pictures of large queues of Iranian nationals in this country who are also looking to vote and take part in this election. So not just Iranians in Iran, but also Iranians outside of Iran are very passionate and want to make the effort to partake in their country's democratic process.
Professor Azadkhan, you know, it's interesting, and I know we've spoken about this before with you specifically, but I wanted to bring it up again because, you know, Ayatollah Khamenei did speak about the fact that it really is a blessing that even though the Islamic Republic is surrounded by insecurity, it's, of course, phrases like the island of stability has been used for the Islamic Republic when literally at all of its borders there is some sort of insecurity, there's some sort of terrorism of sorts, that the Islamic Republic itself is safe and that people are able to go out and vote. Even at 10:15 at night, for example, women, men, old, young, people of all ages. We even had disabled people coming out to vote. I mean, literally everybody feels safe in every province, in every city, throughout this large nation. That's a testament, isn't it, to both the security forces and the system, really, isn't it?
Yes, and I tip my hat to the security forces all over the country, except especially the ones that are close to the borders. Not too long ago, I was on a 15 university lecture tour. We were in the Sistan, Balochistan province, which is in the southeast. And of course, our the Sunni brothers over there, their hearts and minds are with the rest of the Iranian population. This is a province where the Takfiri Wahhabi, who are basically Saudis, you know, without an embassy, are trying to infiltrate and abuse the situation, perhaps with some economic issues that there are in Sistan and Balochistan. And Iran definitely is an island of stability in the midst of chaos. And this is not just regular chaos. These are countries like Saudi Arabia, Qatar, even UAE, many of these Persian Gulf, the sheikdoms, who are dictatorships. And these are countries that the U.S. is selling billions of dollars, and they never had an election in their history. And so not only are they undemocratic, but they're also some of the world's greatest sponsor of terrorism. Meanwhile, Iran is doing all these positive things in the region through its soft power, through its power of persuasion. And Waqar, when I was in Iran, I was trying to pass this on to friends, that any civilization that solely relies on its muscle power instead of its persuasion power is no longer a civilization, nor is it powerful. And this is what we're seeing in this region by foreigners, by foreign interventionists, be it NATO or as far as where we are here in the United States, implemented by these proxy states who never had a democracy. The other little petty regime in the area, who always considered themselves as the sole democracy in the Middle East, and of course by that I'm referring to the Zionist entity, is in fact not a democracy, but an apartheid state. So in all honesty, the only democratic, albeit a theocratic, democratic system we have in the region is Iran. And that's not an exaggeration. That's a fact. We have other countries who have somewhat of a democratic tradition, you know, in their country, and you know, they pass referendums that are rather you know, draconian and dictatorial in order to you know, ensure more power to their executive branch. And I'm not going to say which country, but your viewers are smart enough to figure that out. So in action, based on what we are seeing, based on people's endorsement of the Iranian system, and if you even want to go back to the root of the word, the etymology of the word democracy, which is the root of the people and the engagement of the citizens in the democratic process, be it the parliament, as you brilliantly mentioned, or the Guardian Council, the Council of Experts, all these other checks and balance bodies of power in Iran, the Iranian people have always been involved. They continue to be involved. Based on my understanding of them, they're the most political savvy people in the world. The Western polls always say the Iranians are the most political people in the world. And what does that tell you compared to the country where I live in, where people are not involved? Also, the point I want to mention, because your other guest was speaking rather eloquently about these so-called Iranian dissidents outside of Iran, I can tell you where I live, about an hour north of us, we have these bunch of haters. I don't even like to call them Iranians, but every election season they, you know, go on their little satellite televisions and try to dissuade the public, the Iranian public in Iran, and even the ones here in the United States, not to go out and vote, and, you know, to show their protest that way. So even those people are becoming fossilized, and they're becoming irrelevant, and nobody's even watching them here in the United States, nor in Iran. So the voices of sanity and rationale and reason and peace and honorable reconciliation are certainly on the rise, and they're winning. And this is a great testament to the Iranian nation.
Indeed. And Mr. Khoshchesh, you know, I always wonder about this and always am fascinated by this, that how there's always this effort by a lot of the mainstream media, Mr. Khoshchesh, to try to show that there are irregularities, that the voting is not always smooth in the Islamic Republic. But in fact, there are very strict checks and balances, aren't they, within this country, even upon the media, for example, that there is no unfair treatment of any single candidate, however famous or not, however rich or not. That every single candidate is given a fair chance. That, for example, the campaigning ends a whole 24 hours before the first votes are cast. How important do you think those checks and balances are, Mr. Khoshchesh?
Well, it's very important because just to compare Iran, an election in Iran, with that of the U.S. or any other state in the West, you will see that people need to have large funding, they need to be rich and also supported by a party, a very rich one, and donations do not come just for free. They are coming for something, for some reason. The people who budget, who invest so much money, hundreds of billions of millions of dollars, like for Trump or Hillary Clinton, we saw something around $700 million, if I'm not mistaken, was invested in their campaign. And then when you spend so much money, you expect something from that candidate. He or she becomes your puppet, a puppet into your hands, playing for you, like what we saw in South Korea. With due respect to all Koreans, that's what happened. In Iran, according to the constitution, because there is the state TV only operating, and candidates, no matter who they are, after they are qualified by the Guardians Council, they need to be given fair, equal time for campaigning through TV, and they can speak to the people and talk about their plans and agenda and introduce themselves and talk about their economic and political plans for the future of the country. This is very important because state media, according to the polls conducted by various Iranian centers, especially at this time, in this election, it was the main media to inform the people, and all the people, I mean people from far-fetched areas in Sistan and Balochistan, to the southwest, north, everywhere, they get to know these candidates very easily, and money doesn't talk. And it's their plans and their record and their background that talks, and not money. And this is very important because in a country where the election campaign is run with the help of the rich people, then that country is ruled only by the rich, and people get disappointed and they are discouraged from taking part in the election because they can see that a poor person or a person rising from the poor class of the society cannot come to the top without the help of the rich class. But in Iran, at least for a couple of times, we have already seen that in the last four decades after the Islamic Revolution, that two or three candidates, they won the election while they didn't belong to the rich class or even the middle class of the society. And that's very important for a democracy because people find hope and they have belief in this system.
Indeed, Mr. Carter, I wanted to pick up on and borrow Mr. Chisholm's phrase there and put it to you that money does not talk in the Islamic Republic vis-a-vis when it comes to those who are elected or not. And I wonder, Mr. Carter, that's quite different, obviously, from what happens in the West because, as, again, our previous guest said, you know, we always have these corporations, lobbyists, etc., who try to influence respective candidates. That's quite a significant difference, isn't it, between what happens in the Islamic Republic versus the West?
Yeah, that's very true. No political system is perfect, of course, but one of the biggest problems we're facing over here in the West is the fact that, yes, there is a major problem with money going into candidates and essentially buying their own interests. So large corporations, which, you know, already avoid taxes and have their own personal business agendas, which are not within the best interests of that country or the people of that country. They, of course, have the money to invest in political parties, political groups and people, and can basically buy a politician, and that politician may become prime minister or the president. This has been a big issue that came up in the debate in the American presidential campaign, and Donald Trump actually tried to portray himself as an anti-establishment candidate who was only paying for himself, and he actually did very well as a result of that. He built up quite a good reputation among the kind of working lower to middle class Americans, which is where he got a lot of his votes from. There is, of course, some issue within the Iranian politics at the moment, from what I've seen as an outsider, and that is regarding the issue of corruption within the system. So it might be interesting to talk about that as well. It was a big talking point, if I'm not mistaken, between the candidates to try and curb the amount of corruption that may be present within the Iranian establishment. So actually, money is a talking point in this election in Iran, and I think it is fair to mention that to one degree, as it seems as if that is something which the, you know, of course there's the economy, but also corruption as well, which is a problem across the Middle East as a whole. But in Iran, they seem to be making an extra effort, which is a good sign. But at the same time, it seems that under Rouhani's administration, although he promised initially to try and to deal with this issue, it's still a problem that they're talking about as of now.
Professor Azadghan, I don't want to go into the specific candidates, obviously, because we're very wary of being careful about that here at Press TV at this time, of course, on election day. But Professor Azadghan, I wanted to ask you specifically then about the fact that when we have, as you mentioned as well, the security that is enjoyed throughout the country, there's also then the issue of people feeling secure enough that their votes will be respected as each individual vote. And that's something that Mr. Khoshchesh mentioned as well, that of the fact that the checks and balances that are in place in this country, such as those on media like us, for us not to show any bias, for us not to be to be favorites of any specific candidate, that all those checks and balances are in fact very important for the progress of the Islamic Republic, and that is what will help the nation go forward.
Mm-hmm. And that's where the West, especially Washington, tries to cast a lot of doubts. They want to question the whole integrity of not just the elections in Iran, but every other socio-political economic system that dares to stand up and you know, not following the footsteps of the architects of control, the architects of the New World Order, and wants to play its own manifest destiny instead of the role that has been assigned to it. I basically have been up for 96 hours, Waqar, following the coverage on IRIB, different channels, going from Channel 1 to the news channel, Shabakeh Khabar, which is the 24-hour, 7-days-a-week news channel. And I saw no favoritism. I saw a lot of motivational messages for people to want to participate and to want to go out there and to want to vote. And this is something that's unique. Another thing that I've noticed is that this new thing that's going to take place in Iran is that they're going to determine which province or which city is leaning toward which candidate after the elections are over. Unlike my country here, United States, where the polls close in a certain part of the country and they immediately do these projections. And we all saw what happened in Florida in 2000, where they projected Al Gore to win, and then the Bush crime syndicate definitely called in CNN and other major mainstream media in order to reverse that, because they knew the psychological power of election projections. I think in Iran, the fact that you wait until 24 hours or the next day, even with the highly advanced digital system that you're implementing in this round of elections, shows no favoritism. It doesn't try to create some kind of a psychological base where people would either feel dissuaded or persuaded in other areas of the country to vote for certain candidates. Now, Iran only has one time zone. In the United States, of course, we have three. So when the polls in the East United States would close, they would announce the projection. And then you have states like myself, you know, in California, where we are 3 hours behind, or Alaska or Hawaii, which are even further behind. It would have an impact on their vote. So I think, just like your other guests were saying in earlier programs today, there are many things that Western society, especially my country, especially this Washingtonian system, which is no longer a progressive democracy. Everybody knows that Washington has turned into oligarchy and a corporatocracy and even kleptocracy. There are many things we could learn from the countries that we have been demonizing, including the Islamic Republic of Iran, and implement that here. For starters, we could change the day of voting into Sunday, where people are off and they're more at the ease of mind. Whereas Tuesday has been proven to be a difficult day of the week, a day after the, you know, the start of the week. And that was originally from the very beginning, because we had a very elitist system from the beginning, implemented through the electoral college system, for example, to dissuade people to vote, and basically have the elitist people vote. And here in the United States, we don't have exactly have a positive connotation when it comes to the elite. So instead of being so condescending and so arrogant in our notion of democracy, I think we could look at other countries, especially Islamic Republic. And Mr. Khoshchesh brought something very interesting. The fact that
Professor
money
Azadgan,
does not have
with
as
due
much
respect,
corrosive influence
I do apologize for interrupting, but it's
the election process here in the United States.
I've been told that we may be losing your feed very soon, so I just wanted to thank you for coming on. That was Professor Alexander Azadgan, Professor of Strategic Global Management and International Political Economy, and he was speaking to us live from Laguna Beach. And of course, we appreciate him taking his time out to speak to us here at Press TV.